Hello, YouTube. We're back for another session on the Science is the New Religion script on this Sunday, 17th of October, 2021. I'm joined here with Michael in Germany. Welcome, Michael.
Yeah, hello, Brett. Hello, dear listeners. I'm sorry for my language or for my voice, actually, because I catched the cold a bit. But apart from that, we have agreed on doing one shorter or medium session today, so that the two of us can have some time off for other tasks, because this task here, the Science is a New Religion, is it's so full of people who have influenced our daily life and whose ideas and beliefs actually are being seen as truth today in the 21st century. And that's a big thing, because you see that the majority of people, they do believe a lie which has been told 1,000 times more than the truth, which has been told once or twice. And that's also, I think, that's the purpose of this agenda or the media, to multiply all these lies, so that people say, but everybody thinks about that, and who are you to come up with another explanation, or maybe no explanation, because maybe some things aren't explainable at all. So, second part, after we did Isaac Newton, we are going into Isaac Newton again. And yeah, we mentioned last time that comic here, that people really prefer a reassuring lie than the inconvenient truth. We all know that. We all know that the science revolution means the age of reason or the age of enlightenment. So it comes down to humanity, it comes down to human rights. Human rights, because there is no God anymore, because people believe they are God for themselves. Yeah, so that's the problem here. That's the problem. Yeah. Be not a cancer on the earth. So have no illnesses. Yeah. Leave room for nature, so that nature has been threatened by humanity. Yeah, so that that's why they try to have only the beautiful, young, and healthy, so-called healthy people on this so-called planet. Yeah, it's all a big agenda.
Yeah, you know, Michael, we were talking earlier about 2 Thessalonians, and I think that really applies to what you were just looking at, the Georgia Guidestones. In 2 Thessalonians, it says in verse 10, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, verse 11, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. And look at this. We have Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Here's the lie. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods. Think of the pantheon, knowing good and evil. Yeah, that's what we have today, don't we, Michael?
Actually, the serpent promised knowledge. He promised science.
Gnosis. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Absolutely,
actually,
Mike.
Interesting that gnosis actually sounds a little bit like knowing. So knowing or knowledge means simply knowing something. Science, so-called. You shall be as gods with your science and exploring science. Yeah, science means knowledge. Yeah, once again. So this is the same crap from last time with the three apples, which it's not depicted that it was an apple.
Stupid symbol and, is what it is.
And the rumor with Isaac Newton. So once again,
that was really interesting, our session on Isaac Newton yesterday, because Isaac Newton is claimed by most, even Michael DeSemlian in his book All Roads Lead to Rome, like you pointed out. Even Michael Desemlian pointed out that that this man, Isaac Newton, was a so-called Protestant. But, you know, when you really study what he said, like you did yesterday, when going into what was his biography, and finding that he didn't have real faith, far from it. It only appeared that way.
I think that if you apply for an official seat in the parliament in the 17th century in the United Kingdom, I think you must be a Protestant on the outside, you see?
Oh, of course. You know, that's how it works, because they have the coronation oath that was changed at the turning of the 19th to the 20th century. And you can find that in the Catholic Encyclopedia from 1903 to, oh, I forget now what years the Catholic Encyclopedia was made. I think it was all the way to 1913. You know, they came out with a different book every year or so. And if you look up mental reservation, is it? No. It's the, I'm trying to remember now. I think it's the, it starts with an R, I think. I have to look it up, sorry. But still waking up here. But certainly it's in there, and I'll come back and say that in a minute. But certainly we know that through the coronation oath, they actually refuted the doctrine of transubstantiation and other very important key aspects to completely defeat the doctrines put forward by the Church of Rome.
You see, they are depicting here in that small video, authorized King James Version here. I don't know which Bible he did. I did not an extensive research on him, but I wanted to know what his role is in science. And he's the one also with his laws of gravity, or the theory of gravity, actually, that people therefore more believe in the heliocentric system. Yeah. And he claimed he could tell when the second coming was, and he was into alchemy, etc., 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 etc. And I found something else. I'd like to show it to you. Two things. He took it upon himself to prosecute culprits, and there was an incident with a brilliant scientist named Robert Hooke, who contended he was the one who gave Newton the notion that he led to his theory of gravity and wanted credit for that. But Newton refused and used his powers as a president of the Royal Society.
So he wanted. There it is, Michael. It's the Royal Declaration. Speaking of royal, it's Royal Declaration in the Catholic Encyclopedia. Go ahead and look it up and read all about that. Catholic Encyclopedia. See, the New Advent has taken out all of the juicy truth about the Protestant declaration in the Royal Declaration, actually, the Protestant faith. They'll tell you the truth about it, but they didn't tell you, they took out the fact that they omitted their mentioning of the doctrine of transubstantiation, didn't they? I don't think you'll find it. Oh, yeah, here it is.
Could it be this?
Well, at any rate, maybe we need to look into this. You know, certainly things I remember you know, years ago looking at this, and things are always subject to change on the internet, so I'm not sure. Mm-hmm.
So shall we proceed or shall we look for it?
Let's proceed, Mike. Let's just skip this. This is just a... it's kind of a long study here.
Well, this is the guy who claimed he was the inventor of the gravity, or he led Isaac Newton to that theory. It was Robert Hooke, a scientist, of course. Wikipedia tells us in physics he approximated experimental confirmation that gravity heats an inverse square law and first hypothesized such a relation in planetary motion too, a principle furthered and formalized by Isaac Newton in Newton's law of universal gravitation. Priority over this inside contribution to the rivalry between Hooke and Newton, who thus antagonized Hooke's legacy. Mm-hmm. They disputed over that, so it's not quite clear how much he shared about his talent or his insight, etc., etc. After his death, Newton questioned his legacy. So it's very strange. Very strange thing going up. Yeah. Hooke argued for an attracting principle of gravitation in micrographica. And that's the thing, that they used to have an ether as a medium, or ether as a medium, and then he came up with gravitation. And I'm not going into this because it would far exceed the purpose of that study. Just like to point out what's right and what's wrong, because history is written by the victors. He was also a surveyor to the city of London. We know that it has been founded by the Knights Templars. Mm. So just pointing that out. And also no kind of a picture or portrait of him or something else, painting of him, can be found. And some say that they were destructed on purpose or destroyed by purpose. So very strange thing about this Mr. Hooke. So this is Newton's law of motion. And I'm not going into this now, constant mass, etc., etc. But this was the premise, and this was the science for more than almost 200 years until Einstein arrived with his theory of relativity. So once again, I mentioned that reference work, but brilliant online entries, Jesuit Historiography Online, Jesuit Science before 1773, so in the time when Newton was on. I found something interesting of quotes. It has been highlighted in red. But where? Several books have presented an overview of Jesuits in science. Mordecai Feingold edited such a volume, and in his introduction he described the Jesuits as savants who were quite open and adventurous in their discussion despite the suspicions that such exchanges, especially with heretics, could elicit. William A. Wallace wrote on Jesuits and Galileo, Roger Ayew on Jesuits and Descartes, two on Jesuits in less studied parts of Europe. Augustine Udias wrote a survey of Jesuits' contribution to science, both before and after the suppression of the order of the Jesuits. So there are many interesting books out there. This is another instance of Jesuits contributing to the advancement of science within their Aristotelian context. Bernard Barthier and Antonin Romano turned to the Jesuits in France. Barthier noted that French Jesuits often used the occult, particularly alchemy, magic, and Kabbalah, to help explain certain phenomena such as magnetism, motion, matter, and optics, which they studied in France during the 17th and 18th century. For Barthé, the use of the occult had another advantage to French Jesuit priests because it gave their scientific pursuits a pastoral side. Haha, you see? What a mess. Yeah, people are actually more reliable and been seen as an authority when they wear a priest garment, the garments of a priest.
Yeah, have you ever heard that saying, Michael, you get them while they're down? You know, people go to church typically to have fellowship with other people that have like-minded faith in God. So, in a sense, the Jesuit order has succeeded to infiltrate and dominate a lot of the discussions in the churches and put forth their doctrines without any acknowledgement, because well, quite simply, you're catching people unaware. It doesn't say in the Bible that you should be mindful of wolves in sheep's clothing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been warned. We know in the scripture what it says, but yet when you go to a quote unquote church, like a Lutheran church, like I did, you start to notice these things. It might take a while, but you do begin to wonder about them. I know I sure did. But that was only after a long, long period of trials that I've been through. You know, I've thought about making videos on that in the past, and maybe the day will come when I'll do that. But yeah, Michael, it just it's astounding how deep and wide the infiltration and teachings have spanned in both the church and the state combined, and they use it together. It's a kind of synergy, Michael.
Yeah, every means necessary. Yeah.
Right.
The end justifies the means.
Correct.
And this is official book. Huh? This is a French book of Bernard Battier, Science, History, and Thematics, Esoteric Themes of the Jesuits in France. Hmm? So, Mr. Romano, on the other hand, looked at Jesuit institutions of education and how they implemented the mathematics curriculum from the Collegio Romano in various localities in France. So in France, the Jesuits were very strong. Maybe... Not only, I think that the so-called French Revolution, they served them, huh? Served the Jesuits. Another revolution coming up, huh? One revolution after the other. Christopher Clavius, another Jesuit, published numerous modern editions of Euclid Elements, but this was not the only reason why 17th century Jesuits called him their modern Euclid. It was also because of the tutelage which they had received from his many other textbooks on geometry, arithmetic, and in particular astronomy. Once again, Clavius wrote several editions of commentaries on the Sphere of Sacro Bosco, an important textbook on astronomy from the 13th century. Remember, Mr. Hollywood? So this Jesuit wrote something of a man who most probably never existed. If you smell something, you're in my group, huh?
Oh.
The fact that Clavius rejected the heliocentric cosmos of Copernicus should not be considered a flaw. Very few astronomers, Protestant or Catholic, in the 16th century accepted it. The work of Copernicus was incompatible with accepted physics, and there was no observational data to confirm a heliocentric system. Yeah, that's why they needed the formulas and the tablets of Tycho Brahe. They needed Kepler, and they needed Galileo. Yeah, they needed somebody to prove it. That said, what was it? Robert Bellarmine, I think it was.
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The presumed geocentricity of the Bible was only an added reason for considering the Ptolemaic system most probable, but Clavius' openness to the new is attested by his adoption of Copernicus' precession calculations for his most lasting contribution to astronomy, the reform of the calendar. Mm-hmm. You see?
Isn't that interesting? Here we mm-hmm. come.
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, talk about a revolution, eh? Yeah, that's the title to a song by Tracy Chapman, by the way. But
okay, talking about the revolution, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's quite significant, Michael, in terms of history. Yeah.
It should be noted that the Gregorian calendar, which we still use, was not adopted in Protestant England because of religious reasons until the mid-18th century. Just about the same time that Jesuits began to teach Copernican astronomy as fact, not hypothesis.
Oh, that's a big one. And just about the time that the Oxford movement was on the rise.
Wasn't that 19th century?
Oh, yeah. It started early.
It started early. Mm-hmm.
Early. Oh, yeah. Yeah. So mid-19th century, it'd be well on the way. Mm-hmm. I forget what year it was. At one time, Protestant Henry Newman converted to Catholicism.
We can look that up.
There he is, John Henry Newman. That's it. One to 1890, so he was right in there.
1845.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Galileo's sighting of sunspots. Yeah, remember Robert Bellarmine, Cardinal, said they needed some physical proof. Galileo's sighting of sunspots, the phases of Venus, the irregularity of the moon's surface, and the moons of Jupiter were incompatible, with Ptolemaic astronomy, but they could fit the cosmological system developed by Tycho Brahe, who also could not abandon the Earth's centrality. The Tychonic system had five planets revolving around the sun, while the sun and the moon revolved around the Earth, and it became the preferred cosmology of 17th century Jesuits. In my humble opinion, they only had the Tychonic system because they needed Tycho for the exact measurements. You remember that they had the drawing of the apparatus of Tycho Brahe, which then they rebuilt in China. I think it was some 80 years later. So they needed Tycho, and I think that was some kind of intermediate system to not argue against him, but to slowly convert from geocentric to heliocentric using Tycho Brahe's system as an intermediate, as a pending system, until they can then so-called prove, quote-unquote, the heliocentric system by the use of Galileo and later on Newton. Yeah, this is just a theoretical system founded by the Jesuits in the school system and founded actually thousands of years ago as a counterpart to the biblical geocentricity. And according to Robert Bellarmine, they needed some physical proof. And they came up with some theories. And it is not quite logic to me that these theories could be seen as proof. But I'm not the one to educate people in the school system. These are the Jesuits. They taught, of course, heliocentrism. That's once again, look at their symbol. It's a sun symbol. Okay, let's move on. What is discovered in Galileo's notes, handwriting, that suggested that he learned from the Jesuits how to construct a scientific argument and that his debates with them forced him to organize his thoughts more effectively? Yeah, it's no wonder because he studied for years in a Jesuitical monastery. Vallombrosa, I think it was. Bianchini, like Clavius and other Jesuits, had contact with the scientific society, the Accademica del Lincei, of which Galileo and the Jesuit Johann Schreck were members. We have found that out already. The first trial of Galileo in 1616, in which the Jesuit theologian Robert Bellarmine played a major role. Yeah, sure, he played a major role. He wanted to have physical proof for the heliocentric system. And he was a Jesuit. He was a sun worshipper. And if you say that, no, maybe he was not Jesuit, he was a Roman Catholic. Yeah, they're sun worshippers too. Sunday. From the religious angle, Pietro Redondi tried to turn the issue of the relationship between Galileo and the Jesuits away from Copernicanism when he suggested that Galileo really was guilty of heresy because he promoted atomism in his book The Assayer, so that the lesser charge of his support of heliocentrism saved his life. Huh? Interesting. I haven't checked that out, but just to let you know. Yeah, you see, this is all our theses. They cannot prove it. Yeah, but you see, that has been seen as the majority of people. You see, they have always, they are always wrong. But
democracy, eh?
Democracy, yeah. Yeah.
Sounds familiar. Noted,
yeah. Feldhain noted that Jesuit took advantage of this to study Copernicus' work, but the Dominicans still shunned it. Feldhain maintained that this difference in approach exposed the Jesuits to suspicion of heresy by the Dominicans. Yeah, of course, they were jealous because they took away the Inquisition from the Dominicans. Huh? So maybe they had some revenge or something like that. I don't know. Yeah. And now comes the interesting part. While Feldhain showed the flexibility of the Jesuit approach to science that often allowed them to immerse themselves in the study and encourage their contributions, critics have pointed out that Feldhain assumed a monolithic society of Jesus that did not exist. Yeah, well, they swear an oath to the generals. So that's a monolithic society. Yeah. Yeah. I don't care for the explanation left or right. You see, I look at the symbolism of Jesuits. I know they have been ordered from the Roman Catholic Church to establish the Counter-Reformation, so I know that they are sun worshippers. Yeah, you see, if I would not know that, I would not be a Bible-believing Christian. Okay, so much. Yeah, also Athanasius Asius Kircher in the 17th century occupied the chair of mathematics in the Collegio Romano. There were museum exhibitions in Rome and in Stanford devoted to Kircher, and he was so-called the last man who knew everything, which treated many different aspects in his polymath biography called about sampling of his work, Egyptology, Kabbalah, chronology, cosmology, paleontology, magnetism. So everything which could solve any problems. And this is from the Westphal biography of Newton, which we mentioned in the last session, page 152. Having searched after knowledge in ye prophetic scriptures, he began, I have thought myself bound to communicate, if for the benefits of others, remembering my judgment of him who hid this talent in a napkin, for I am persuaded that this will prove of great benefit to those who think it is not enough for a sincere Christian to sit down contented with ye principles of ye doctrine of Christ, such as ye apostle accounts, the doctrine of baptism and of laying on of hands and of the resurrection of dead and of eternal judgment, but leaving these and the like principles desire to go on unto perfection until they become of full age and by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Hebrews 5:12. People should not be discouraged by past failures to understand these writings. God vouchsafe the prophecies for the edification of the church. They are not about the past. They were written for future ages. When the time comes, their meaning will be revealed in their fulfillment. Let people be warned by the example of the Jews who have paid dearly for failing to recognize the promised Messiah. If God was angry with the Jews, he will be more angry with Christians who fail to recognize the Antichrist. Thou seest, this is a quote, thou seest therefore that this is no idle speculation, no matter of indifferency, but a duty of the greatest moment, unquote. One cannot be too careful. The Antichrist comes to seduce Christians, and in a world of many religions, of which only one can be true, and perhaps none of those that thou art acquainted with, one must be circumspect to find the truth. Already we perceived that Newton's interpretation of the prophecies was not unconnected with his Arianism. And I have found that website called Religious Views of Isaac Newton. And there is also here the Trinity, prophecy, etc. And we have to search for anti, of course, anti, not anti-Joch, yeah, anti-Christ. Yeah, anti-Christ. It says, Newton believed that the papal office and not any one particular pope was the fulfillment of the biblical predictions about Antichrist, whose rule was predicted to last for 1260 years. The day-year principle, etc., etc., etc. Here's a quote. Let's look it up, where his source comes from. A plea for religion of sacred writings. So it has been said that he exposed the papacy at the Antichrist, but you see that every reformer in the 17th century did that, and he was the chief of the Royal Society of Science. I don't know if he really believed this or if he was really a believing Christian, but he took away some glory of Jesus Christ or the divinity of Jesus Christ, and he tried to explain gravity and all this stuff, and I highly doubt that he was a real Christian guy. Seems to be that he was not that polite guy. I have a hard time believing that.
Isn't that interesting? They recognize the historicist view in this article.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, go ahead, Michael. I don't.
Yeah, you see, it is very hard to. We shall not judge anybody. We are judging the people by their fruits. He was the head of the Royal Society. He came up with the explanation of gravity, and I think that gravity has nothing to do with the Bible. So don't tell me that he was a real believing Christian. I think that the end justifies the means also in the case of Mr. Isaac Newton. I don't want to say anything bad about him, but I highly doubt that he is a real Bible believing Christian. Yeah. So we could go into his biography once again.
Well, we did yesterday, Michael. There's no need to go back, is there?
Yeah, that's a quote I've just read, and that is the only quote in the Antichrist comes to seduce Christians, and in the world of many religions comes. Yeah, I don't know if that is future or what. I'm not native speaking Englishman or American. But I didn't find the quote of the papacy. But maybe it's not in that kind of biography. Yeah. So see, zero results. I don't know where that quote comes from. So pardon me, but I cannot back that up. Newton quote papacy. Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, he believed. Yeah, please show me. Show me the source. Yeah, you see, these are the sources. This is the overall source. What should it be? Papers show Isaac Newton's religious size prediction of apocalypse. Associated Press. Oh, this is an official release of the AP news agency. Okay, so we have to believe it. Papal? Antichrist or what? So where is the source? I cannot see the source. If I look it up, that Wikipedia article with Antichrist, with papal, no, zero, nothing, nada, papacy, zero, nothing, nada. Do I have to download any PDF or what? Cannot see it. You see, they refer to that article here. Yeah, and I cannot find papacy, papal, or antichrist in it. Claim from Wikipedia with no source. This is the book of Daniel. This is the book of Revelation. And this is that article from Associated Press. Maybe it is no. The original cannot be found. So I cannot promise you that he did recognize the Antichrist as a papacy. You see, that has been written here, Brett, but I cannot back it up.
Isn't that something?
Don't have the original source. Can guess it from his calculation of Charlemagne becoming the Holy Roman Emperor.
How about that reference 41 at the very bottom of the page? Is that anything of Newton? No. Jonathan Edwards, okay. Nothing in Newton, though.
You see that maybe he was opportunist or he wanted to be very high in his career. I don't know. God has to judge him, not us. We are just pointing it out. Okay, so then we go to the thing which I think that is quite logical, has to come up. It's a kind of...
You know, Michael, that is interesting you point this out, because if you were to take this for face value, be like, wow, I think, Isaac Newton's right on it, you know, and you can't back it up.
And not on Wikipedia, especially. So I can look it up if I find it in the usual Wikipedia article of Isaac Newton, but I would highly doubt that. No. Antiquities, yeah. No.
That's right.
No. 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 And why should they?
Oh, what did you find that on there? Where was that?
In the religious views of Isaac Newton.
Religious views.
Yeah.
I see. They separate the article. It's not part of the main article. Oh, wow. Yes. How clever is that?
Mm-hmm.
Very clever. Isn't that something?
Yeah. Newton believed that the papal office and not one particular pope was the fulfillment of Antichrist. Yeah. Okay. Maybe. Don't know. Cannot back it up by any source at the moment. Yeah, we can take hours for doing so, but you see that I think that is he believed Nietzsche.com. Voltaire's essay. Ah, Voltaire was a Jesuit, so Antichrist. Yeah, he finds a clear to a demonstration that the Pope is the Antichrist. Yeah, that is a comment from Voltaire or something. Voltaire's essay on Newton. Translation of the works of Voltaire. Uh-huh. So Voltaire claims it that Newton said that at first sight here. Yeah. I do not find that very important at the moment, because you see, we do not know if it was his official meaning or if it was his private meaning. I don't know. You see that he seems not to be, he seems only be interested in the theories of prophecy and so on, more in the mathematical issues of the Bible than, anything else, I say. So, cannot solve the riddle. Sorry, I don't have any time for to do so. If somebody wants to do it, you're absolutely welcome, and I would be glad to hear your sources to back that up. Next one's coming up is the pendulum clock. Yeah, a clock that uses a pendulum, a swinging weight. Sure. Some Christian Huygens, it was. Yeah. And that was an invention in the 17th century as well by Christian Huygens. And he was interested in mathematics, and he demonstrated a hanging chain and not a parabola, as Galileo thought. And Galileo came up with another experiment from the Tower of Pisa, actually. And they were into these pendulums. Yeah, pendulum's clock must be stationary to operate. Any motion of acceleration will affect the motion of the pendulum, causing inaccuracies, etc., etc. So they are only accurate when they are standing still. Uh-huh, interesting. Yeah, you see, this is a pendulum clock, or later we will find out that it's the same as a grandfather's clock. Mm-hmm. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. Yeah, that has something to do with isochronism. What is isochronism? That is isochronism. From ancient Greek, chronos, equal time. Something which is happening at regular intervals means isochronal. Yeah, chronos, yeah, the time giver. Chronos is also a variation of Saturn. Hello. Yeah. Okay, so let's go. The first pendulum clock was invented by 1656 by Dutch scientist and inventor Christian Huygens and patented the following year. He constructed the clock designs to clockmaker Solomon Costa, who built the clock. Huygens was inspired by investigations of pendulums by Galilei. We know where he was educated, Mr. Galilei. Vallombrosa Monastery, Jesuits, former Benedictine Abbey, I think. Galileo discovered the key property that makes pendulum useful timekeepers, isochronism, which means that the period of swing of a pendulum is approximately the same for different sized swings. Galileo had the idea for a pendulum clock in 1637. Huh? Huygens was inspired by Galileo beginning around 1602, but Galileo had the idea for a pendulum clock in 1637. You please explain that logic to me. The introduction of the pendulum, the first harmonic oscillator used in timekeeping, increased the accuracy of clocks enormously from 15 minutes per day to 15 seconds per day.
It's simply, you know, Michael, have you ever heard of two people having the exact same idea, but coming at it a little differently and having no communication with each other, but one just comes up with the idea and does it, and the other may have come up with it first, but never did it.
Okay, maybe that was that.
That could be an explanation. I'm just throwing it out there.
Okay. So these things were known as grandfather's clock with their mechanism. I think we don't have to explain the mechanism of it. And now you know why I came up with the grandfather's clock. A gravity swing pendulum. So you have to believe in gravity, because at almost the same time, or nearly the same time, when these clocks were introduced or patented and everything else, that was the time when Mr. Isaac Newton came onto the stage. Yeah? So the two support each other. And I'm not going into all these formulas now, because temperatures, atmospheric drag, local gravity, this is all worldly science. Let's go to the nitty-gritty. I found a website which has mentioned in the link article, the link section of Wikipedia. It's called the Not So Simple Pendulum. Not so simple means complicated, huh? Not so simple. I found that today, the not so simple pendulums. And when I now scroll all this article, then I think you got a headache like me today, but my headache is coming from the code. It is commonly known that Galileo discovered that the swinging weight exhibits isochronism, perpetually by noticing that chandeliers in the Pisa Cathedral had identical periods despite the amplitudes of their swings. The advantage here is that the driving force of the pendulum, which is difficult to regulate, could vary without affecting its period. Galileo was a medical student in Pisa at the time and began using it to check patients' pulse rates. Yeah, don't forget that that he was not only studying medicine, but he also studied at a Jesuit monastery. Hmm? And once again, Robert Bellarmine needed a proof, a physical proof. Remember, Brett? Mm-hmm. Robert Bellarmine needed a physical proof for the heliocentricity or for the Copernican model for that part. It is actually the same. The Copernican model is heliocentricity.
Sure.
Sun-centered system. It was Christian Huygens who built the first pendulum clock as we know it on, could it be, Christmas in 1656. Yeah, what a present to the Pope, huh? 1656. Remember? Galileo's trial was in 1636 or something.
1637, yeah, something like that.
Yeah, so 20 years later, he came up with that pendulum clock. Huygens' later measurements by John Richter of this geographic variation led Huygens to assist this variation to centripetal force from the Earth's rotation, which is indeed latitude dependent. So that is the explanation here, why on different locations, that clock has several behavior, so to speak, led to assign this variation to centripetal force from the Earth rotation. Huygens and Christopher Wren proposed the distance as a standard unit of length, 39 inches, but were unaware at the time of the geographic variation of this length. In 1793, the meter was standardized as 1/10 million of a distance between the North Pole and the equator based on curvature estimates from triangulations by Delambre and McCain. Okay. I know what we are all waiting for, but I cannot handle that matter in that session here. So, very complex thing, very much a formula for people who are absolutely keen on mathematics, physics as well. Yeah, feel free to investigate on your own, but you cannot read everything here because then actually you will get a headache. And this is, as you see, sounds reasonable, huh? Sounds very professional here, all this mentioning of sources, some mathematical stuff in it, etc., etc., many, many, many sources in it, and references, okay? So you will say that is a professional article based upon the inventors of that model. This is the response from people who are into physics. Yeah. So you can have it your way, or you can have it the fast way. You can read everything and you can calculate everything, but if the root is wrong, then you don't get the correct result. Because you see that some people claim that, oh, you are using the wrong formula, because the formula as suggested by Ron is poor in comparison to a logarithmic one I introduced in one of my recent works. Yeah, you see the unity of so-called scientists. Huh? So there's contradiction also in their science. We do not know who's right or wrong. And this is a special language which is not understandable to somebody who's not who's not a talent or is not into physics at all. Yeah? The next one, Emerson says that, it's not actually caused by pressure variation. Buoyancy change due to density change due to temperature change alters the restoring torque. Absolute humidity change alters density and viscosity and then rate of energy loss, equilibrium, amplitude and period. Got me? I think you didn't understand any word of it. Yeah? So this is just the special language of scientists and everybody has his theory. And you see, this is contradicting. Yeah, everybody says, oh, no, I've got the right formula. I've got the right idea. Oh, no, this is not working this way. It's working the other way. Yeah? Okay, you see that? Somebody says a pair of $12 wristwatches would have been a godsend in the 17th. I found that very interesting. Yeah, somebody else says I wrote my master degree thesis on the chaotic response of force pendulums. Chaotic response, interesting. Uh-huh. Chaotic response. Okay. Yeah, you can keep yourself busy with that. I'm not intended to keep you busy. Yeah, you can spend your entire life with formulas like Isaac Newton. See? That's why I came up with the legendary Foucault pendulum. Leon Foucault, the man who did let the Earth rotate. I didn't know that a man would be able to do so, but this is just a German text here. Mm-hmm. So on the 3rd of January, this is German here, I'm sorry for that, 1851, the French physician Leon Foucault had a test in his basement with a 2 meter long, which means about six inch, seven long pendulum over the ground, etc., 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 etc.
These 6 feet, Michael. 6 feet.
6 feet. 2 meters. 6 feet.
Yes.
No, I'm a little bit more.
3 feet per meter. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So they say it was not the pendulum which alters the direction, but it was the Earth. And so he did the same measurements in Paris at the observatorium. These experiments were being held in the chapel in Cologne, and in the chapel of Spire, but they weren't successful or not satisfying, etc., 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 etc. So that is because of the gravity and the Coriolis force. That would be very interesting. So this is a regular explanation of gravity visualized. Gravity visualized. So somebody is here on that surface, which is not flat, yeah, but it is curved, as you can see here, with a little spot or little hole here in the center, or almost in the center. I cannot recognize it from that view, from that perspective. And this is a so-called teacher who explains there, oh, this is the gravity which pulls the things to the center. Yeah, it is no miracle, Brad, that it has been pushed or pulled or what else to the center, because there is a hole in it and this is not a flat surface. Ever played golf? So with that, they really try to explain gravity. Once again, as I said in the last episode, last session, Brad, they always try to explain gravity in a vertical way, so from top above to the ground. Yeah, that's their gravity. They cannot explain it and they cannot show it, they cannot prove it if you have two objects on the flat plane. Yeah, that they have a certain kind of influence on one another. I haven't seen that. Two stones,
right.
Yeah, two things, yeah. And don't come with magnets, yeah. This is magnetism. You can measure that. It has nothing to do with gravity. Yeah, so this is, in my opinion, it's totally BS, that experiment. It just tells you that something which has no centripetal force, so that's the merry-go-round here. I hope you can see my mouse here. Yeah, so if you're on a merry-go-round, yeah, and you lose the centripetal force, yeah, then the rotation becomes slower, and it moves to the center, and finally it is stuck here, and it's been motionless, more or less. Sure, if you lose that force here, if the force of motion has been lost, however you will try to call that, yeah, then the rotation will stop and then the object will be drawn to the center, but not because of gravity, but because it is steep here above and this is down below. This just rolls down. That's it. It has nothing to do with gravity, in my humble opinion. So I think that is absolutely to distract the people. This is my opinion about it.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Now, please remember all these complex explanations about these forces which we have discovered there. Yeah, to blind someone with science means to confuse by the use of big words or complex explanations and with use of many formulas and contradicting evidences. And people say, no, it's this force, it's that force, it's gravity, it's this, it's circular, and all the things. Yeah, cannot be simple, must be complex. To blind people with science. That's the big one. This is the ball. This is the pendulum, or the ball on the pendulum at the end of the pendulum, actually. Yeah, and this is a circle on the bottom, or at the bottom here. Yeah, maybe with a copper plate or something like this. Yeah, and that pendulum swings. So this is a so-called Foucault pendulum. The Foucault pendulum or Foucault's pendulum is a simple device. The device is simple, but the explanation is very complex. Named after French physicist Léon Foucault and is conceived as an experiment to demonstrate the Earth's rotation. So the only value of that is not to serve mankind. It doesn't feed anybody. Yeah, the only purpose for building this was to so-called prove the Earth rotation. And actually, if you look to Wikipedia, they tell you, yes. In German, they say, yeah, it could be proven. Yeah, that's hilarious. They take that for granted. Yeah, you see, it nachgewiesen werden kann means could be proven. Yeah, you see, this is the animation for it. So they say, okay, therefore you can prove that the Earth is rotating. Now let's go to the English Wikipedia. English. To demonstrate the Earth rotation. As an experiment to demonstrate the Earth rotation. Yeah, it's an experiment to demonstrate. In, where is it located? In the Pantheon, Brad.
I'm not surprised.
Not surprised.
Not Maybe surprised they... by yeah. 1 second on this yeah. one.
And in their notes and their references on that page, it's been said here, low-tech proof of Earth rotation, Foucault's new mechanical proof of the rotation of the Earth. Yeah? So they're speaking about this an experiment which is proving that the Earth is rotating, actually. Oh, there's an error. Yeah, and let's say to the proof. Where is the proof? The experiment made by Mr. Foucault, Monsieur Foucault, is set both in the direction and magnitude of the motion of the plane of oscillation of the pendulum fully to conform the indications of the theory. The difficulty, however, of the mathematical investigation of the subject, the difficulty, oh, weren't we told before on the main article, Brett, that it was a simple device? Mm-hmm. And now it turns out that there is a difficulty, however, of the mathematical investigation of the subject and the delicacy of the experiment, liable as it is to so many extraneous causes of error, have induced many persons to doubt either the reality of the phenomenon or the satisfactoriness of the explanation. Another experimental proof, therefore, not depending on the rotation of the Earth, that the plane of oscillation of the vibrating line remains at rest with relation to the vertical component of the real axis of rotation may not be unacceptable. With this in view, I have devised the apparatus I am about to describe. Uh-huh. Used by the use of big words or complex explanations. I will copy it into it, so for later.
Experimental proof. There we go. Yeah.
Okay. So let's present the Foucault pendulum at the United Nations headquarters in New York. It is installed in the main lobby of the General Assembly building. The United Nations promote international cooperation protecting human rights means excluding God. And the general explanation of it is that it proves that the Earth is rotating, so that the Earth is minor compared to the importance of the Sun in the so-called heliocentric system, Copernican system, etc. Once again, Robert Bellarmine wanted to have a proof. He needed to have Galileo's calculations. He needed to have the gravity theory of Isaac Newton, and he needed to have more or less a physical proof. A physical proof is not a formula of Isaac Newton. A physical proof is not a calculation of Galileo. A physical proof, so to speak, would be that pendulum. Am I right or am I right?
Supposedly, yeah.
Supposedly, yeah. Yeah. And so this pendulum is in the Pantheon, where the gods live. Where the gods live. Yeah. 24 hours. It takes a little bit more than 24 hours here to rotate the ball. Okay. Foucault's pendulum swings under the dome of the Pantheon in Paris. Under the dome. The pendulum is a demonstration that says on a certain website.
Oh,
is
I
a
demonstration. Thought the Pantheon was in Rome, Michael.
Yeah, you see that Paris has been named after a Trojan king.
I didn't know there was a Pantheon in Paris.
Me neither.
Wow, isn't that interesting? Wow.
From the classical Greek word temple to the gods. To all gods. It stands in the Latin Quarter. How surprising, huh?
What is the Latin Quarter?
Yeah. The Pantheon. Looks familiar. By the time the construction was finished, the French Revolution had started. In 1851, Leon Foucault conducted a demonstration of the Yonan motion at the Pantheon by suspending a pendulum from the ceiling, a copy of which is still visible today. Everybody needs his Pantheon. I was thinking about, are we doing first Charles Darwin or doing the pendulum? You see that because I was a little bit tossed around Charles Darwin, and it is almost near the same time. And I said, okay, let's start with the pendulum. Let's start with gravity because we just made Isaac Newton. And so I thought it would be better to proceed with the pendulum instead of Charles Darwin and all this stuff. Okay. Yeah, the ashes of Voltaire were placed in the Pantheon in lavish ceremony in 1791, followed by the remains of several martyred revolutionaries, including Jean-Paul Marat and the philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau. So it is also a place of worship. It's a temple. Yeah, it's nevertheless Pantheon meets temple. Temple for pagan gods. Has nothing to do actually in a Christian world or city or what?
Okay, so I'm reading the Latin Quarter in Paris. It says, known for its student life, lively atmosphere, and bistros, the Latin Quarter is home to a number of higher education establishments besides the university itself. Okay, University of Paris, that is. That's very interesting.
Including the Sorbonne University, which had been taken over, as far as I'm concerned, whenever I had a reading of Griesinger with Jörg, by the Jesuits.
There we go. Hey, yeah. It's home of the Jesuits. Hey, any surprise here, Michael?
Yeah, once again, it is in Paris, yeah? And it's not arrondissement of Paris, so this is the number of districts, but it is Paris once again. Paris is the capital and most populous city of France.
Oh, look at the Roman arch. Hello.
Yeah, and look at the obelisk. This is an obelisk symbol. Huh? Many people don't get it.
And the pyramid.
Yeah,
at home with the Counter-Reformation.
Yeah, this is the Arc of the Arc. Yeah, where to start? Yeah, you see, this is the Louvre. This is a museum in the shape of a pyramid.
Oh yeah, it's on the intro to the video.
Freemasons, anybody? Yeah or no? Yeah. The Arc de Triomphe. Yeah, so the Triumph Arc. Yeah. The Arc de Triomphe, which is also depicted as a female womb here. This is a Roman Catholic symbol for a female womb. And it has been said that this is also a sun gate, yeah, more or less, and many other things too. And this is the
sun gate. Very interesting. Very interesting.
This is the Eiffel Tower, which is not only a tower, so an obelisk, but also has the same arch underneath. Like you cannot see it from that perspective, I think.
No,
but
that's
yeah,
true.
There you can see it. There you can see it. So it combines male and female symbolism or architecture, actually. Yeah. Iron Lady. Yeah.
Wow.
But I wanted to go on to...
That's Paris. What it actually means in French? Iron Lady?
No, it's just a nickname.
Oh, okay.
It's called the Eiffel Tower because of Gustav Eiffel.
Oh, yeah, that's an interesting nickname.
As Iron Lady, yeah.
That's a very interesting nickname when you consider the way that, you know, the Catholic Church is the two iron legs and the Nebuchadnezzar metal man image in the Book of Daniel. And what more can we say? The woman? Representing a church, not an actual woman or women, actually in biblically represents a church.
It gets worse. Yeah, you see that Paris is often referred as the city of light, both because of its leading role during the Age of Enlightenment.
Yeah,
and literally because Paris was one of the first large European cities to use gas street lighting on a grand scale on its boulevards and monuments. But that doesn't tell me what Paris actually is. Paris has something to do with the city of Troya. Oh, it's not been mentioned here. How can that be? Etymology, you fail me.
Oh, wow.
Been mentioned in the first century before Christ. Yeah, by Julius Caesar. and Lutea of the Parisi, later as Parisian, then as Paris in 1265. During the Roman period, in Lutetia, Lutetia, that doesn't sound like Paris. The name Paris from its early establishment. My, they run around in circles around you, huh, to confuse you here. Mm-hmm. Paris is often a city. It's unbelievable, huh? I don't want to be fooled. Paris mythology. Yeah, so there you got it. Onyx Alexander. Greek Empire. The son of King Priam and Queen Hecuba of Troy appears in a number of Greek legends. That's what I said. Paris is a Greek son of a king, King Priam.
I see.
The elopement with Helen, the queen of Sparta, this being one of the immediate causes of the Trojan War. That's what I told you before. Later in war, he fatally wounds Achilles in the heel. Yeah, there comes the quote. With an arrow, as foretold by Achilles' mother Tethys. The name Paris, probably of Luwian origin, comparable to Paracetus, attested as Hittites scribe, etc., etc. Etymologically unrelated to the name of the French city of Paris. Ha! yeah, which derives its name from a Gaulish tribe called the Parisi. Yeah, okay. Where did they have the name of the Parisi? The Gallic tribe of Parisi. Yeah. That's why they have a pantheon, by the way. The pantheon is full of Gallic goddesses or not? Oh, sorry, I forgot. The pantheon means a Greek goddess, huh? Ah. You see, they will never tell the truth. They will never tell the truth. The meaning of the Gallic etonym Parisi has been debated. Yeah, you see? It is absolutely futile to go into this. I say once again, I'm absolutely sure it has been named after the Greek origin and not after the Gallic people of Parisi. You see, the Parisi must have their name, anything. You see that the Parisi in the first century before Christ, Greek root before Christ, three centuries before Christ,
correct,
actually. Yeah, so, and the Greek mythology is far more older than Alexander the Great. So the meaning of Parisioi had been debated. It may derive, but maybe not, but possibly. propose,
yeah, just skirt legend around has the truth, it, Michael.
Rumor, where is the myth?
Oh yeah,
explaining or tradition. By
complex explanations your history.
The city of Paris attested as Lucerne by Caesar in the 5th century AD. Yeah, in the 5th century AD. Yeah, that's hundreds of years later. But let's go back to the Pantheon.
Script, yeah. Yes,
yeah, Pantheon,
yes.
Yeah. Pantheon.
Oh, Paris isn't that Pantheon.
Yeah, you'll be fooled every time. Yeah, you will be fooled every time. They are laughing in your face, and they actually think that you are then too lame, too lazy for any kind of research. Yeah, so that you will never get to the truth. Not Pendulum, Pantheon. Yeah, how better place for a Pendulum than Pantheon? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you see, Pantheon. The name comes from Greek, and it comes not from Gaelic. Of French or Romanic things, but it comes from pantheon, means pan, means all, or the Greek god Pan, the god of panic, yeah, which is a depiction of Satan, and theos means god, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, on the hills of the Holy Genovia in Paris. Yeah. Was been planned as a church of the mighty Abbey of Sainte-Geneviève. Yeah. Roman Catholic somewhere. In the
Saint
order
Genevieve.
Of...
Is that right? No, we would say
could have switched to the yeah. Yeah. Original plan for the church of Sainte-Geneviève. Yeah. Final plan looks like looks like everything else coming from the Roman Empire. Yeah, so you see that you it's futile. You see, it's futile. Yeah, they will lie in your face. threads from the inside, and a website, some website, so one of billions of websites quoting that the pendulum is a demonstration evidence, proof, anybody, where is the proof? Yeah, we have looked it up in Wikipedia and we cannot find the real proof for the Earth rotation. I won't repeat all the technical stuff here, said the author. It's available on Wikipedia, haha, and from other sources for anyone who is interested. Yeah, then please tell me that there is absolute proof of this pendulum. Versions of the pendulum exist all over the world. The first time I encountered one was on a school trip to the United Nations headquarters in New York. And Mr. Leon Foucault has nothing to do with Michel Foucault, because you see that this is a guy from the 20th century. So don't mix it up, because I thought that, oh, that's interesting, but then I said I found out no. But you see that there is one Foucault pendulum in New York, in the United Nations building. What else is in the United Nations building, Brad? Can you see it?
Oh, well, I know there's all kinds of stuff there, but go ahead, Michael. I don't know what you're talking about.
There's a checkered floor.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
There are columns, like in a temple. And on the back, you see some kind of a Roman or Greek figure or Olympia or something like that. I haven't looked it up who that depicts or who shall that depicts. But this is in the hall of the Foucault pendulum. The General Assembly lobby has a Foucault pendulum given to the United Nations by the Netherlands in 1955. Why the Netherlands? Because there was this Mr. Huygens who invented that kind of a pendulum in, it was, I think, 1656 or so. The pendulum, this is United Nations. Let's look it up. I hope I got it from that source. Yeah, visitors lobby. Oh, colorful pictures. Mm-hmm. Actually, here it is from the other side, from the other view. Yeah, or here. Yeah, and here you see what they are telling you. The pendulum offers visual proof of the rotation of Earth on its axis. It was presented by the Netherlands in 1955, consists of a 200-pound gold-plated sphere, gold, religious item, suspended from a 75-foot ceiling by a stainless steel wire. 1993, in the western side of the lobby, has a stained glass window designed by the French artist Marc Chagall. In the visitors' lobby, a variety of curated thematic, informative, and educational exhibits are shown. The east side is lined by windows with a view of the East River and the delegates' launch terrace. Yeah? So the UN side, UN.org, look it up here, UN.org tells you that the pendulum offers visual proof of the rotation of Earth on its axis. So they are more intelligent and educated than even Wikipedia. You have to believe it. It's official source from the United Nations. You cannot doubt any authorities. You have to obey the authorities. Yeah. Remember the film They Live.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah?
They Live. Don't question the authorities. They Live or authorities. I know that is just a movie. I know. Yeah, but I'm quite frequently using it. Yeah, obey authority. Yeah, so that's the United Nations. Don't question anything. Consume. Yeah, money is your god.
Yield.
Obey, conform, buy. And this is from the 80s. You remember the picture from? Sorry.
Watch television. It says.
Yeah, but stay asleep. Yeah, but it is from the 80s. You can see it by reproduce. Yeah, this is a thing which would not be used nowadays. Yeah. You don't have to reproduce. Remember the 10 so-called commandments on the Georgia Guidestones. Yeah, you have to steer the fertility wise or something like this. Yeah, you have to be very careful when you have to multiply. Yeah. Yeah, there it is. Okay. So the United Nations tells you that there is visual proof of the rotation of Earth on its axis. Mm-hmm. And there are educational exhibits. So then we compare that. Yeah. So the pendulum offers a visual proof for the education of the people of the rotation of the Earth or something like that. Yeah. So you see that educational exhibit. So they like to educate the people with the pendulum. So don't question that the Earth is rotating. We have a pendulum. We have a Foucault pendulum. Okay. Do you believe the United Nations? The United Nations are very prominently known for North by Northwest from Alfred Hitchcock. This is a scene from that very movie where a murder happens in this movie from 1959, UN scene, North by Northwest from Alfred Hitchcock, who was Jesuitically controlled or Jesuitically educated. Yeah, and he kept his horror by his side and viewed this in his movies. He was not friendly to women, to his female co-stars, let me tell you. You know, from Psycho and Vertigo and all this stuff. Yeah, and birds, especially. Yeah, so this is the view from top of the United Nations. Now, you don't see the pendulum, obviously. Yeah, you see kind of a lake here. I just wanted to picture out that United Nations is a very, very famous building. But what is a pendulum? You see, nobody cares about it. If you type in Foucault pendulum, everybody tells you, yeah, it's a visual proof of the rotation of the Earth, and oh, there are several pendulums. Yeah, all looks very fancy, all looks very nice. But actually, they come up with difficult explanations to blind people with science. Yeah, but they need a pendulum for that. Mm-hmm. They cannot prove it other way. They have to use the pendulum. This is the physical proof that Robert Bellarmine was looking for. Okay. Next, in the script, you won't believe it. Actually, do you know that the pendulum is much more older than the Foucault pendulum? And can you imagine what kind of a purpose it served? We have to go back to the occult. Oh, yeah, we just have read that the Jesuits in France used the occult. Can you remember that?
In this session.
Sure. Yeah. So the Jesuits used the occult because they were priests in France, and we are now located in France. Léon Foucault was a French guy. This is the French. We have talked about the French Pantheon, the Paris Pantheon, and Léon Foucault, if I was not mistaken, was a French guy, or was it he?
No, you're right. That sounds right. That's a French name.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, a French physicist. Yeah. So, 19th century.
Yeah.
So, this is a long-awaited proof for Robert Bellarmine of the Jesuits. First of all, this came into my mind. Edgar Allan Poe, who was also in correspondence with the Jesuits because he lived nearby a Jesuit, I think it was a college or so, and he was befriended with several Jesuits, and he had a very short life which ended by alcohol and on several mysterious circumstances. He married his underage, I think 14 or 30 year old niece, etc., etc., so like a pedophile, and he also came up with only with horror stories, The Fall of the House of Usher, The Raven, The Telltale Heart, The Cask of Amontillado, etc., etc. There is a very prominent, famous album, music album of Alan Parsons, who used to be the engineer of the Beatles. In Abbey Road is a Freemason road. There's a Freemason obelisk standing there, etc., etc. So don't want to bother you with that, but you see that the pendulum also is an instrument used to torture people. Physically, not spiritually. Physically. Okay? The pit and the pendulum. Where is the pit mentioned in the Bible?
Ooh. Book of Revelation, Michael.
Of Revelation. Yeah, you see, that was one of the things you have to look in symbol in symbols also. The pit and the pendulum. 1842. Yeah? 1842. We're speaking about Léon Foucault, who came up with the pendulum when was it? 1850. Mm-hmm. Come on. 1851. Yeah? Foucault pendulum, 1851. Okay. So, Mr. Edgar Allan Poe came with the horror story of the pit and the pendulum in 1842. Not saying that they are both are related, but you see that when this comes down and there's a sharp edge on it, people will be killed. Hmm? Pit and the pendulum. Look at this. The story is about torments endured by a prisoner of the Spanish Inquisition. Though Poe skew historical facts, the narrator of the story described his experience of being tortured. The story is especially effective at inspiring fear in the reader because of its heavy focus on the senses, such as sound, emphasizing in its reality, unlike many of Poe's stories, which are aided by the supernatural. The traditional elements established in popular horror tales at the time are followed, but critical reception has been mixed. The tale has been adapted to film several times. A prisoner of the Spanish Inquisition, I said, Interesting, huh? At least interesting, I think. I hope. Yeah? So that's the first thing is coming up. Yeah? It's not the last thing, I can promise. Yeah? So that has what Edgar Allan Poe is depicting here is that somebody is brought to trial before the Spanish Inquisition. Yeah? So then we are talking about the Jesuits. Or the Dominicans. I don't know what timeline he now has, but yeah, I think he voted in 1842. Spanish Inquisition. I find no timeline here. The Inquisition was, however, abolished during the period of French intervention in 1808. Yeah, but okay, but yeah, it was a story of 1842. So that was what I wanted to share. That there is a relation to the Spanish Inquisition. Or might be on by accident. Poe may have been inspired to focus on the purposeful impersonal torture in part by Juan Antonio Lorente's History of the Spanish Inquisition, first published in 1817. It has also been suggested that his pit was inspired by a translation of the Quran. Yeah, please don't mention the Bible, huh? Don't mention the Bible here. Okay, so I don't want to I want to cut it short a little bit here, but the original source of the pendulum torture method, so one paragraph in the preface of the 1826 book The History of the Inquisition of Spain by the Spanish priest, historian, activist Juan Antonio Lorente, relating a second-hand account by a single prisoner released from the Inquisition's Madrid dungeon in 1820. Okay. So this is the first thing. So that is has been mentioned here a few years ago, where the pendulum was then being installed in the Paris Pantheon, there where the gods live, which is a Greek pantheon, by the way. So sorry, I have to look one thing up here. The pantheon in Paris. So they will tell you that there are Greek goddesses. It took the form of a Greek cross. The facade in peristyle modeled after a Greek temple featured Corinthian columns and sculpture by David Dangas, blah, blah, blah. Napoleon Bonaparte. Yeah, I want to know for called pendulum. Yeah. Original pendulum, the crypt, the tomb. Yeah, sure. I wanted to know what kind of gods they present in that pantheon. You see that we have seen the picture of gods, but they don't tell us. No, that's not good. Okay, so that was the torture method of the Spanish Inquisition. But there is much, much more, and much more occult, and much more older than this. I've brought it with me. This is this. The pendulum has been used regularly for hypnosis and or the occult. Hypnosis, or Hypnos, is the son of Nyx and Erebus, the darkness. His brother is Death. Both siblings live in the underworld, Hades, or Erebus, another valley of the Greek underworld. Huh? Once again. Yeah. He is said to be calm and gentle god, as he helps human in need and due to their sleep owns half of their lives. Hypnos lived next to his twin brother, Thanatos, the Death personified in the underworld. Hypnos uses his powers to trick Zeus. That is Jupiter in Roman. So that means Hypnos uses his powers to trick God. Hypnos was able to trick God and help, etc., etc., etc. And help, and now, look here, please, Brad, and help the Danaans win the Trojan War, and there is Paris. So, Hera, that's the wife of Zeus, and Zeus is unfaithful to her frequently. Zeus robs Europe. Europe is the lover of Zeus, so Jupiter loves Europe, okay. So the Roman Caesar also loves Europe very, very much. And asked him to help her by putting Zeus or God to sleep. So this is hypnosis. Hypnosis derived from his name, referring to the fact that when hypnotized, a person is put into a sleep-like state. Hypnos, sleep, and osis means condition. Yeah, the class of medicine known as hypnotics, which induce sleep, also take the name from hypnos. The English word insomnia comes from the name of its Latin counterpart, somnus, means not sleeping or not no sleep. Okay, and yeah, regarding to him is Morpheus, the god of dreams. And even in a German doctor, Ärzte means doctors, Zeitung means illustration, in a doctor's journal, they say that without Pendel and without hocus pocus, medical hypnosis helps patients with chronic diseases or chronic pains. Yeah? Morpheus can morph in different forms and appear in dreams. Also, a relation to bats has been described. Yeah, Morpheus and his brothers from Peter and Phantasos Oniroi. There comes Oniromancy or Onirois. That was one ability that the so-called Magi had. The explanation of dreams. Yeah, it's Oniromancy. Remember from the Medo-Persian.
Yes.
Yeah. So they've been named as dream demons or dream or demons in a dream. This is the mythical thing about these sleep and dreams. And yeah, to put what was it here that is very, 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 very important here? No, I'm sorry for my skipping here. Yeah, that is very much important here. We will refer to that very soon. So, coming up, the drug morphine comes from the name of Morpheus also. Yeah. So, also the drug, pharmakeia, yeah, has a name of a Greek god. Isn't that interesting?
Huh? Yeah, Morpheus? It is.
Morpheus is a fashioner derived from the ancient Greek, is a god associated with sleep and dreams. God of dreams. So, and now we're going back. This is the depiction here also of a, called, of a spiral or any shape like a spiral or alternating circle, which is from the Depeche Mode video, Behind the Wheel. Yeah. So behind that wheel, there is something to discover, which is hidden. Yeah. And also there is a spiral goddess also, which is a depiction, spiral goddess. For the spiral goddess, you see that here this spiral she has in her belly, yeah, the spiral goddess neo-pagans, etc. Yeah, this is a depiction for hypnosis too, and I can tell you where that has been displayed 20 years ago. Wiccan community spiral goddess known as Lula, triple goddess, yeah, Trinity goddess, etc. In Kylie Minogue, can't get you out of my head, Brit Awards, there, yeah, in that video where she's doing a ritual, maybe we can see it here, I think we can see it here, yeah, was it a bit too late, yeah, there you can see the spirals, yeah. That's the shape of the spiral goddess on that video. Just want to mention that. Hypnosis means a person to put into a sleep-like state. There are other things coming from the occult as well. This is not available in English language. This is only in on the German Wikipedia. This is a so-called siderisches pendulum, which means a Siderian pendulum. From Latin, means a star picture, related to stars. And pendere means to hang. So this is a tool for radio ecstasy and other esoteric teachings, where it has been tried to receive certain information. You can make unconscious items visible. Yeah, it is not scientific provable. And yeah, you see, this is a Derrick Pendle with a Pendle diagram. I have explained it or translated it into English. In antiquity, pendulums already heralded war. The first user account of one heard in 371 from Pliny the Elder as part of a conspiracy against an emperor, Venance been set on conspirator's pendulum consisting of a shell fiber ring of thread and on its own side to belong to 24 letters of the alphabet Gravieri. This is a depiction of alphabet Gravieri. This is serpents. Yeah. Yeah. This is the ululat, that's the owl. That's a rabbit, etc., etc. Okay. That means you got your question here. You got your ancient alphabet, and you ask a question to the spirits, to the spiritual world, and you just hang the pendulum in your hand, and in that direction where the pendulum then is oscillating or pointing or so, that's the answer to your question. That is a very, very old occult sign or method of foretelling. That's a pendulum. That is actually one of the oldest use of a pendulum. It has nothing to do with a scientific thing. This is just summoning up evil spirits.
Oh, by the way, Michael, just a quick little note. There's also something called a plumb bob that you use in carpentry to make a level line in building. That is meant to be still and use mm-hmm. it to determine a plumb line. So when you're building, mm-hmm. you get a very straight mm-hmm. column or a straight yeah. wall or a straight, surface that you can go measure perpendicular and get, that kind of thing. So yeah. It's almost the same thing, except... Yeah. When you use it in that regard, you keep it still and it doesn't move.
The Siderian pendulum was being used by the German Navy in the Second World War in the hope of a group of experimentalists to get knowledge about the position of enemy submarines. Yeah? So we're talking about the Second World War. The tendency of the pendulum in the direction of a certain response can be explained with the so-called Carpenter effect. But you had to spoil it, Brad. Yeah? You had to spoil it once again. Every time.
Every time.
In this case, it is sufficient if the commuter wants the pendulum to go in a certain direction. As a result, imperceptibly, small muscle movements bring the pendulum in the desired direction without the commuter having to consciously give the push. It's a little bit similar to
kinesiology. Kinesiology. I know what
that's right. Also a kind of an esoteric thing.
Right. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay. So Ludwig Straniak was a German mystic and a pendulum dowser. He was an architect and astrologer and was used by the German military in the Third Reich, not necessarily willingly. Two of more well-known mystics other than Straniak used in the Third Reich by Walter Schellenberg through Heinrich Himmler, whose relative was a Jesuit priest, who, as far as I know, who had a great deal of interest in Germanic mysticism and revivalism, were Wilhelm Gutberlet, who was a pendulum dowser, and astrologer Wilhelm Wolff. I think that was the guy who has been sent a wrong horoscope by the British Secret Service, if I remember correctly. But you see that there are so many things in my head at the moment. I cannot tell it for sure, and I don't want to go into this. Yeah. Straniak claimed to have a special gift for map pendulum dowsing. Straniak would dangle the pendulum over a given map and so-called locate things. As a test, leaders of the German Navy requested him to locate the pocket battleship Prinz Eugen then at sea. The Navy provided him with charts and were reportedly amazed that he had pinpointed the warship even though it was on a completely secret mission off the coast of Norway. Citation needed. This impressed the Navy leaders enough to take the workings of the occult unit of the SS more seriously. This also inspired the character Captain Jack Sparrow in Pirates of the Caribbean. Interesting. According to Karl Spiesberger in his book Reveal of the Power of the Pendulum, Straniak believed that brass was the most suitable material for all kinds of dowsing and that even fruits such as apples, oranges, pears, and lemons demonstrate a polarity at each end. Well, what do we say about this? They just want to point it out, you see? He was also, it's very strange here, revivalist.
Oh, revivalist would be someone who's reviving a ideology or some previous, yeah, religious mm-hmm. thing, yeah.
Okay.
Wouldn't it be?
Yeah, it has been wrongly translated in German. It's like der Kund can...
I see.
Survive, they can't bring dead people alive or so, that very strange translation here. But just to point it out. Yeah, Magic Unveiled, a Codex on Pendulum Magic by Albertus Crowley. This is an artist name. It's not a son of Crowley. But you see, there are also, also books. Yeah, I wanted to point it out. There are also books on Pendulum Magic.
Man.
Yeah, an occult codex that will teach you how to use a pendulum. A pendulum is a very old subject of foretelling.
Can we break that down? Pendulum priest?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, magic with a K. You see, that is Aleister Crowley. No, of course. No, not Albertus Crowley, but magic with a K is the synonym for magic of Aleister Crowley. Yeah, this I just want to point out that the pendulum is not a scientific object per se. Okay, that's my part. Okay, that's nothing to do with here. Many forgeries.
Yeah, indeed, it's an occult instrument, Michael. That's what I'm getting.
It's an occult instrument, or been used as an occult instrument.
For sure.
Finally, the Bible, Psalm 104.5.
Uh-huh, and reads in German. Okay, and then we have English. Who laid the foundations of the earth that it should not be removed forever?
Yeah, according to that, I'd say that the earth is fixed.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and now you see, I found that link. Openbible.info, topics, the earth orbiting the sun. 100 Bible verses about the earth orbiting the sun. And what do you find? You find that psalm. I'm amazed. I don't know sometimes what to make up of things. If a website tells me these are 100 Bible verses who are clearly depicting that the earth orbiting the sun. Yeah. So in my English, German understanding.
Oh, ESV.
Yeah, okay. You see that there are more than 100 Bible verses here, and I could not do the work to translate 100 things King James Version. But you see, the big point is that you see that in my humble English, I think that means that the earth is orbiting the sun. But actually, the Bible depicts the other way around, that the sun is orbiting or the sun is going down and going up.
Correct.
The Bible does not speak that the sun orbits. So this is absolutely futile here, but I wanted to show how many Bible verses there are who are related to the earth and the sun in relation to it. Yeah, or the earth, how the earth has been fixed, that the earth has been fixed. And if the earth has been fixed, the earth does not move. Because fixed is quite the opposite to move.
That's the world we live in, Michael. It's completely upside down, inside out, and backwards. Everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they get away with it, don't they?
Mm-hmm. I know it's from the ESV. I'm sorry for that, but you see that you can imagine I could not help it to translate.
No. It's just further proof, Michael, that what they're doing with this is they're just simply exactly. They're just putting a spell on you. They're lying you in your face, and you just sit there and take it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can. You see that every time I look into the Bible verses, I get the impression that the earth is fixed. Yeah, in Joshua, it's been said that the sun stood still, so that is the exception here. So usually the sun is moving and the earth is fixed. Yeah, how hard can it be? And the moon stopped. Yeah, so that usually, and many people claim, oh yeah, this is just from your viewpoint. The Bible has been written not as a scientific book, but more or less a fairy tale with many names in it, and it just been the depiction from the earth how things are appearing on the sky. Yeah, that's what they try to get away with it.
It's Gnosticism all over again, man.
Yeah.
Over
yeah.
and over and over again. Over and over and over.
Yeah, I'm sorry, this is just the ESV. I'm usually not quoting any other Bible than the King James Version, but apparently for that kind of work, I can't help it. Yeah. Yeah, it shall never move. The world is established, shall never move. Yeah, so thousands, no, not thousands, but more than 100 verses about it. Yeah. The sun rises and the sun goes down. The foundation of the earth, nowhere near you can find that the earth is spinning. Foundation of the earth.
Wow.
Yeah, look it up. There's so many things here, and we cannot go into every Bible verse, of course.
Well, Michael, I think the very subject that we've entered into is impossible to put into a small space of time. This takes many hours to go through.
I know. And we are quitting it now here, but I just wanted to end it with some Bible verses, although they are from the ESV, to simply show you that the Bible from a long time ago just simply depicts no fixed sun, no solar system, no heliocentric system, no sun god, no Sunday, and especially not a moving earth. I don't find anything. Yeah, rising of the sun to its setting. Sun stands still at Gibeon. The sun will be darkened. Yeah. Foundation of the world were laid at bare. And also, something is coming up into my mind at the moment. What kind of... I have to look it up. Yeah, there it is. Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Yeah, can you imagine a footstool which is moving constantly? Oh yeah, then heaven rotates too as well, so that it appears, you see, that they will try to deceive people. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Yeah. You see, the problem actually is that most of the people who are into the heliocentric system, they don't read the Bible.
Why should they, Michael, if they place their faith in man? They're already, you know, unless they repent, you know.
So thanks again for your time. Next time we go into the next part of the scientific revolution, the age of enlightenment, and the second part of the Foucault pendulum. Okay, so I think that we did a great deal, and next time we will show you some other interesting book sources and claims as well, and then you can compare it to your Bible. So please read your Bible and please join us the next time. Handing it over to my beloved brother Brett. God bless.
Yes, thanks, Michael. It's always a pleasure to go through these with you and just touch base on, you know, where all of this stems from. Very interesting. We open and close on the picture of the pendulum every time, and here we are speaking about pendulums. And yeah, I'll be looking forward to the next one, Michael, where we continue in our journey into the past and present in the realm of the so-called science mentioned in the Bible. And I'm looking forward to then, and God bless, and Maranatha.